You know, one of the things I like about these shows, like for example, when she played the part of Laura on the Mickey Mouse Club, she made a mistake, and she apologized for it. What a life lesson to teach kids. You don't see that on television anymore. Isn't that wonderful? And anyways.
That's what Disney was all about, really, was good family values and teaching kids to be good. I mean, the Mouseketeers were a perfect example, so that's great.
Tell us about the Mouseketeers.
Well, the Mouseketeers were a great group of kids. It's interesting, most of them were not professionals. I think Annette, Walt Disney saw her in a high school program or something, and she was, or a ballet show or something, I don't remember. And there were just a couple of them that were actual professional actors before. But the kids were great. I was telling Tom earlier that it was the mothers that were the problem. The mothers would sit in a big auditorium, because in that days, and maybe you have to do that now, I don't know, it's been a lot of years, but in that time, until you were 18, you always had to have a parent with you, and you always had to have a social worker. And during the school year, you had to go at least, in fact, they had a little red schoolhouse, and Mrs. Seaman was the teacher, I can remember that perfectly, and the kids, you had to go to at least, I can't remember how many, I think it was like 3 hours a day, and you could be interrupted for 15 minutes at a stretch only, and then you had to go back to school. But it was so interesting, because the mothers would sit in the auditorium, and one would grab, well, how come your daughter got a close-up today? How come she's got a part in that? I mean, and my mother was right along with them, so they were the typical stage mothers of the Mouseketeers. The kids were great. There was no, I don't think there was any jealousy that I was aware of with kids. It was the mothers.
Who is your favorite Mouseketeer?
Oh, gosh, that's a hard one. My favorite Mouseketeer probably was Bobby. Bobby was a cool kid, yeah. And he went, of course, you know, went on to Lawrence. He's the only one out of all those Mouseketeers that grew. None of the rest of those kids grew. They were all this, and I was too tall to be a Mouseketeer. And so, anyway, they were all little and stayed little. Oh.
Who was your favorite singer?
Doris Day. And Teresa Brewer. That's where, when you saw the Lawrence Welk show, I used to idolize Doris Day, and I liked Teresa Brewer because of how she squeaked in every song.
Tell us about Annette Funicello.
Well, I don't remember an awfully lot about Annette. I lived kind of far away from the studio, and so I didn't do a lot of things with the kids. I was always invited to their parties and stuff, but Annette was just a sweetie. But she had big aspirations. She wanted to do other things other than Disney. And when the Mouseketeers went off the air, Annette was the only one that was left under contract. And so she started doing the beach movies with Frankie Avalon. And that's when Disney dropped her contract, because they didn't care for the bathing suit and all that stuff. So, but she was, and I think Tommy Kirk was just behind her too. So those two, I think, were the only two that were left.
Tell us about your filming with Ronald Reagan and Nancy Davis.
Well, that was really fun. I had an interesting story that actually my mother related to me the day after, is that you didn't show the scene where I get mad and I have to slap him across the face. Because I think, as I recall, the story was that supposedly he was responsible for my brother or something being killed, or I thought he was responsible because he was a cavalryman or whatever. And he comes to the house to see my mother, and I'm really mad, and I have a scene where I have to slap him. And, of course, I just kind of went like that. And he says, no. He says, I want you to really hit me. Well, I walloped him one, and I knocked his bridge loose, and I didn't know that till the next day. So I have that claim to fame. I knocked Ronald Reagan's bridge loose.
So you slapped the president.
I did. I slapped the president. And they were very nice, by the way. And Nancy Davis, that's when they were engaged, and I don't know how long afterwards they got married, but they were engaged at the time.
Well, you know, when you saw the clips of Ronald Reagan and Nancy Davis in these short clips, you could mm-hmm. see that they were in love with each other.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, they were. They were just nice people. No.
Tell us about Kevin Corcoran.
Oh, Kevin Corcoran. As you know, he played Moochie in the Shaggy Dog, and for those of you who remember Disney, he played Moochie in almost every Disney thing that they had. And I remember one day we were shooting the Shaggy Dog, and Kevin, I think, was like 8 years old, and told him that his dad had just died. And it was so sad. I can just picture to this day him just walking out with his little head hung, and it was really sad.
We didn't show it, but one of my favorite lines in The Shaggy Dog, when his brother, his older brother, turns into a dog, he then turns back into a boy, and then he turns back into a dog. I mean, that's what the whole... And by the way, this was a new technique that Disney had perfected just for this movie, which is one reason it had such incredible commercial success, the idea of transforming a dog and a boy within, you know, seconds of each other. That Disney worked forever to get that perfect. And so one of my favorite lines from the movie, when the little boy says, Kevin Corcoran says, gee, I like you better as a dog.
You know, the Shaggy Dog was one of the biggest money grossers that Disney ever did. So, and it cost, I think, a little under $1 million to make. I mean, it was, you know, of course, those were back in the days when they didn't have the huge salaries, but it went on to be one of the top Disney movies. And it was fun. Okay.
What's your favorite role in any of these?
Oh, my favorite role in any of these probably was Because They're Young with Dick Clark. Loved. I got my first screen kiss from Doug McClure in that. And so Doug did the movie, then he wanted to do Checkmate, and then went on to do The Virginian. So I had known Doug a while, but that was the most fun show because we had Dick Clark and Tuesday Weld and Victoria Shaw and Warren Burlinger, and it was just fun. It was just a really... Dwayne Eddy, do you guys remember Dwayne Eddy, who used to play the... Yeah, he was on the show. It was just fun, really fun.
Tell us about your friendship with Ricky Nelson.
Well, Ricky was, I think I did like four or five or six of the shows, I can't remember how many, but he was just the sweetest, nicest, shyest person that I think I'd ever met. When Ricky and David worked together, Chris Ozzie was the director also, and he would tell Ricky what to do, and Ricky was just kind of like a little puppet. He would do everything his dad said, and David was just the opposite. He would just fight his dad constantly and argue with him. But about 4 months before Ricky was killed in the airplane crash, he came to Salt Lake to do a performance at, I can't remember, it was a dinner, one of those dinners, playhouses, yeah. And he performed, and oh my gosh, he looked exactly the same. The only difference, and he sounded the same, the only difference was he was a little bit heavier, but you know, it happens to all of us as we get older. But anyway, and I went back afterwards and talked to him, and I remember he introduced me to his little fiance, and he was just a really sweet guy, really sweet guy.
The tell us about your horsemanship on the Virginian.
Oh gosh, I didn't have any. I'm scared to death of horses. When I found out I was going to do the Virginian, they asked me if I could ride a horse. And of course, you know, in those days, whatever they ask you, you say yes, and then you run out and do lessons. And I had two lessons on a horse. And one day we were on location. It was really hot. It was like 100 degrees or something. We were out someplace, and I was supposed to be doing a galloping scene, and I couldn't control my horse, and I absolutely panicked. And luckily, there was a wrangler at the end that stopped us, but I never rode a horse again. I mean, I would sit on one if I had to walk in the scene, but everything you saw after that was my double. It wasn't me. And Lee J. Cobb was just as bad. We were the laughing stock of the cutting room floor because there was like that much difference between the horse and us when we would trot.
What she's trying to tell you, she was only on the horse when she got in and got off. The doubles did
the
rest.
That's about it. I even had trouble doing that, so let me tell you.
Now tell us, when you were speaking French to the dog, did you Do you speak French?
No.
Well, your accent was so beautiful. How did you manage that?
Well, I had a tutor. I had a tutor that helped me. And luckily, I didn't have to do that much French. But they hired a French lady to work with me, and she kind of taught me a little bit about the accent. And of course, she taught me the lines that I had to say in the show. So that's pretty much how.
Well, didn't y'all think her accent was beautiful?
Oh, well, thank you.
Did y'all not think she stole the show in The Shaggy Dog?
Oh.
I mean, I don't want to take anything away from Annette because she's wonderful, but she stole the show.
Well, I owned the dog. That's why. So,
tell us about the remake of The Shaggy Dog with Tim Allen.
Well, when they did this last the last remake of The Shaggy Dog, they decided that they wanted to bring out the original Shaggy Dog, and they brought it out on CD, and they had like the regular version and the colorized version, which incidentally is nothing true to the color whatsoever. But they had Tommy Kirk and myself and Kevin Corcoran and Tim Considine. And they had Tommy and Kevin one day, and then they had Tim and I the next, so I didn't get to see Tommy and Kevin, but they had us, you know, ask us a lot of questions and talk about the show, and then they would play the show, and we were supposed to be commentating through the whole show, and Tim was reading a sports magazine the whole time because we were off camera, but I was telling Tom earlier that I hadn't seen Tim in, I'll bet you 35 or 40 years. And had I not known that he was coming, I would have never recognized him. Because when I worked with Tim, he had the crew cut. And when he walked in the set, and I only knew it was him because I knew he was coming and there was nobody else walking in. But he had long hair, a beard, and was a little porkier than he was, but if I'd have passed him on the street, I would have never recognized him. I guess we all change, but he had really changed. So, but it was fun. It was fun that we were interviewed together, and he. It's interesting. He told the story about when he was found out that they were going to do Shaggy Dog. That he went into Bill Walsh, who was the producer of the show, and told him he'd read the script. He said, "It's the stupidest thing I've ever seen. Why on earth are you making this silly show?" And of course, you know, now he eats his words a lot, but he came from a vaudeville family, and he just thought that The Shaggy Dog was literally the dumbest show he'd ever read in his life, the dumbest script.
Well, I think it made Disney enough money to produce Mary Poppins, because it took a lot of money for Walt Disney to buy the book Mary Poppins from the author, because she didn't want to sell it to him because she was afraid he was going to water it down and distort the story. So it took some bucks, and he got the bucks from The Shaggy Dog.
So yeah, he did. Big
so
bucks.
She, in a way, she helped us bring Mary Poppins to the screen.
Oh. Well, that's good to know.
Tell us about how Disney discovered you.
I don't remember. I was doing I don't know if any of you remember the Pinky Lee show, but at one time that was the number one children's show in the country, and it was color, it was NBC every single day of the week. And I was on that show, and I remember those were the days when they didn't have teleprompters, and they would hold up the cheat sheets, and I was blind as a bat without glasses, and every day I had to learn a brand new song. And there was one day in particular where I got on camera and my mind went literally blank. And of course, Pinky Lee, who was from vaudeville himself and did a lot of tap dancing, he came on and saved the day and tap danced around me. But when I was on that show, getting back to your question, when I was on that show, I was introduced to a gentleman by the name of Cy Miller. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with the song, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Do you all know that? Well, Cy wrote that song, and he became my vocal coach. And I was fortunate enough to be one of the very first people to ever sing that song. And Cy introduced me to an agent who at that time was, it was the William Morris Agency. I can't remember the name of the agency, but they were... Debbie Reynolds, he was Debbie Reynolds' agent, and Bob Hope and a lot of the big stars, and they're the ones that got me the audition into Disney. But I really was too tall to be a Mouseketeer. And somebody sent me a tape of one of the songs that I did. It was Teach Me How to Yodel. By the way, if you go to Disneyland, if you get to a small world, it's just an exhibit. When you come to Switzerland, I do the Swiss yodeling in that. I did that when I was like 16 years old, and I can remember they were in the process of building this. And I forgot what I was saying. What was your question?
What was my question?
Yeah.
How did Walt Disney discover
you? Oh. Anyway, so I just auditioned, but I did a ton of work with Disney. I did voices for their cartoons. I did screams for Annette, because Annette couldn't scream. I toured with all the kids. We went to Australia, did Fun with Music Day, Talent Roundup, did this, sang at Disneyland, did a lot of stuff at Disneyland. So I did a lot of recordings with Disney. So I did a lot of work, but I was going to tell you, when they showed the song, Teach Me How to Yodel, I was standing in the middle, and the kids were literally dancing around me, and I was a head taller than every single one of those kids. And I was this height. I have a little bit of heels on, but I was this height when I was 12, so you can imagine how short those kids were, because I'm not very tall, actually. Did that answer your question?
On the Pinky Lee show.
Oh, he was a dirty old man. Sorry.
I didn't ask that question.
I know. Thought I'd throw that in. And he's dead, so I'm okay on saying that.
No liability. Who was the performer? Was it Pink Lee? Where you helped with the sing the cigarette song?
Oh, Tex Williams.
Tex Williams.
Oh, in fact, this is how I actually got into show business. When I was raised in Southern California, and that time when they would have like a big supermarket chain like Lucky's or whatever, they would have a real big grand opening, and they always had Tex Williams and his Western band. And my parents used to drag me around from supermarket to supermarket. And I would get up, you know, a couple of times Tex would let me get up and sing with him. And at that time, he had the show from Knott's Berry Farm before it became a commercialized place. It was actually a farm. And we sang, he had a show down in the corral. And the song that I sang with him that got me on the show was Smoke, Smoke, Smoke That Cigarette. So that was his hit song. So that's basically how I...
It actually is a satire on smoking. And even though the lyrics keep saying smoke, 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 cigarette. If you listen to it carefully, it's a dismal subject. So it's actually an anti-smoking song, but comes across as smoking. And
he was the nicest human being I have ever met. Tex Williams was. Oh, he was so nice. He was really a real gentleman.
So you helped Tex Lee with the song.
I did.
Tex Williams' song.
Well, I don't know if I helped him, but it got me on his show. And I was 10 and a half years old.
Wow.
Yeah, 10 and a half years old.
You were on The Virginian. Mm-hmm. And tell us about some of the people who starred on the show.
Oh, we had a lot of people. A lot of the big stars in those days. Henry Morgan. Who were we talking about on the way over here? Lee J. Cobb, of course. But... who played Baby Jane? Betty Davis. I'm sorry, I had a mind blank. Betty Davis. Vera Miles was my all-time favorite person to work with. She had the most fun sense of humor. She was such a beautiful lady. And I remember one night we were doing a scene together on a train. We were in the train, and it was like 9 o'clock at night. We both had been up at there since like 6:30 that morning. And we got the giggles. We couldn't stop, and they finally just had to shut down. And we came back the next day. But she did several of the shows, and we had Fabian on, and of course Robert Redford. That was, I think, one of the first TV shows he ever did. In fact, if any of you have read his latest bio, he talks about a couple of times about The Virginian, saying what a pleasure it was to work on that show because of the quality of actors like Lee J. Cobb. He mentioned Lee J. Cobb twice twice in his book. So that was fun. I had a interesting, Ryan O'Neill was also on our show. And he at that time was married to Joanna Moore. And I remember going up the first day on the set and I, you know, just introducing myself to him. And I said, you know, I'm Roberta Shore, I'm on the show. And he looked at me and says, you know, I'm married. And I said, okay. Was just trying to be friendly. But I can honestly say most of the people were nice. I can only think of one person that I thought was kind of rude, and that was Forrest Tucker. And that's because he brought nude pictures of his showgirl wife on the set, and I thought that was kind of not very nice. So, but other than that, everybody was great.
I'm going to bring the microphone down, and she'll entertain questions from the audience. But you must speak into the microphone for two reasons, for those who have hearing challenges, and then secondly, we want to capture your question on tape, so when the television audience watches the answer, they'll know what the question was.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have two daughters, and I have five grandchildren, and I have a grandson who just went to Argentina on a Mormon mission. So.
And I assume that they've seen your picture, your movies, and old TV shows?
Do you know, I'm not so sure they have.
Really?
I don't think they really care.
I was just wondering what their reaction was when they see you on the screen.
Do you know, to be honest with you, I'm not so sure they've ever seen me on the screen.
So they just know you as mom and grandma?
They just know you as grandma. Okay. And I'm not so sure they'd be even impressed. although I will say that I was on YouTube or something, and under the comments, one of my grandsons says, hey, that's my grandma, and that's about it. So.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Don't be bashful.
Yeah, please ask some questions. Okay.
You started in your career at such an early age. Can you give us the chronology of how long you were in the Disney world and also all your other shows, and then what you did after that?
I had my first TV show when I was 10 and a half. That was Tex Williams. And then after that went off the air, I went into Pinky Lee. And I think I was with Pinky Lee about maybe a year and a half, and then that went off the air, and that's when Disney came in. And then after that, my first love was singing. I really started out as a singer, and the acting just kind of, because I sang on Pinky Lee, and the acting just kind of gradually came along. But I left the Virginian. I think I was 21 or 22. I actually left it to get married, and I walked out of a 7-year contract. I was put on suspension for, I think I had 3 or 4 years left in my contract. And they said I couldn't do anything. But unfortunately, I married a man who was very controlling and very jealous of my career. So I basically pretty much quit then. So does that answer your question? That's a quick chronology. Thank you.
Don't be bashful. This is your one chance. Hold on, you got to speak into the microphone. Because nobody else will hear your question.
I just want to know where you live now.
I live in Salt Lake City.
And she flew in just to talk to us.
I did. I flew in.
why don't you go ahead and tell them about the festival?
I can't remember the name of it. It's what? Oh, Spirit. Oh, sorry. These are our Virginian posse people over here. The Spirit of the Cowboys. Oh, thank you. Oh, wow. And it's over at where?
Chestnut
McKinney.
Square.
I'm sorry. I travel a lot, and I can never remember where I am at one place.
It's at Chestnut Square in McKinney.
Okay, it's McKinney, and it's all day Saturday and all day Sunday, and I believe it opens at 10. And there's going to be a lot of people there. Jim Dury is going to be there, who, of course, was in the Virginian. Bob Fuller. Don Coyne from the show, Gary Clark from the show. I can't remember who else, but there's going to be a ton of people there, and it's really fun. And we're going to have entertainment, and it's Les Gillum. If any of you have heard Les Gillum, he is absolutely fabulous. It's country western, but it's worth it. So it's going to be a lot of fun. So if you guys can come and see us. Any more questions?
Over here.
Oh, okay.
You know, we know you from the public view, but I wonder if you would share if there's anything in your life that you feel like is a personal triumph or that happened with you or your family that really, you know, humanizes your life. I know that a lot of times behind the scenes, we don't know what happens behind the scenes, but usually there's a thing or two that just means a lot to you that you think is a personal triumph in your life or a personal tragedy that you overcame.
Well, probably the most personal thing was I overcame breast cancer. So, you're going to have me crying up here. But that was probably my most wonderful thing are my children, of course, and my grandkids. There's nothing better than grandkids. They're just the best. But that was, and my late husband died of a brain tumor at 45, and I have since remarried to another widower whose wife died of cancer. So we've had our fill of cancer. But I am 100% great, so. That was probably the biggest personal tragedy that I went through, that and losing my husband. So, now let's do something cheery. Okay.
This is not a question, but a comment and a compliment. A couple years ago, Memphis Film Festival, you and your husband, did
love letters. Yes.
And it was so great.
Thank you.
And I think it was a kind of a spur of the moment thing,
yes,
wasn't it?
It was because Will Hutchins was supposed to do it with me. And he was very ill. He was having heart problems. And my husband is an actor. In fact, he has his PhD in fine arts. And he taught at Emporia State University drama for years. In fact, he has a theater named after him. And he does, now he's an adjunct professor at the University of Utah, and he also teaches drama, and we had done that together ourselves. So actually, it worked out better for the two of us to do it. Oh, sorry. The two of us to do it, because it's you know, I didn't know Will Hutchins, and he didn't know me, and it's such a personal play that I think it worked out better for my husband and I to be able to do that, since we're married, and I didn't know Will, so it may have been a little bit strained there. So, sorry, I got.
We'll take one last question. Yes, ma'am.
I lived in Emporia, Kansas
for
35 years. Yes.
How long ago?
We came down here exactly 9 years ago. We raised our three daughters there. We're originally from Buffalo, Niagara Falls, New York.
But
when you said Emporia, I thought, oh my gosh.
That's amazing, because none of my friends
there.
None of my friends had ever heard of Emporia.
Yeah.
So it's a college town. Did you ever see any of the homecoming shows?
Yes.
My husband directed probably a lot of those and was in a lot of them.
And his name was?
Ron Fredrickson.
Oh my gosh, yes. Abs, I can't believe it. Oh, I'm sorry.
Small world, isn't it? Oh my gosh.
Very
I'll
small.
Tell him. He'll be here tomorrow.
Will he?
So come to the festival and you can talk to him.
We will do that.
Oh,
and I'll bring
for
my
sure.
husband then. That is amazing. So you lived in Emporia?
No, Rod is from Salt Lake.
Okay.
And when his wife passed away, he came back to visit his family, and we actually started dating. That we had like a long distance relationship for like almost 2 years, and then after we got married, he was still teaching. So
okay.
We had a first year and a half, it was like having a legitimate affair. It was kind of
right.
fun. We just kind of went back and forth.
Okay.
So
yeah. Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it when you said Emporia.
Oh.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any last minute? Okay.
Mm. Yeah, you haven't said anything about The Father Knows Best and Billy Gray. You have got anything comments about that show?
You know, I don't remember. I was really young in that show. I vaguely remember Billy Gray and I don't remember a lot of them. I didn't work on any show that the people weren't really nice, and that is really nice to me. So, but I don't. That's one of the first TV shows I think I ever did.
Yeah, because you're still listed as Jimmy Shore.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. In fact, I was telling Tom that my maiden name was Shorup, S-C-H-O-U-R-U-P. And it didn't look like it sounded, and so nobody could pronounce it right, and so we just cut it off and shortened it to Shore. And when I was doing Shaggy Dog, whenever there was any kind of publicity that came out about the movie, if there wasn't a picture along with the article, they would referred to me as a he. And so Walt Disney actually is the one that suggested that I change my name, and my name is Roberta Jimmy. So, because back in those days, everybody changed their names, but you had to go to court to do it, to legalize it. And so I just took my first name, which I never go by, only in my career. I always go by Jimmy, which is my middle name.
Now, Jimmy, Roberta promised me, I told her that she told me she wouldn't sing.
That's right.
Except one song with one condition. You all have to stand up and join her in singing it.
Well, let's pick a song.
Well, you had said...
Happy Trails. Happy Trails. That's the...
She said she would sing Happy Trails
if everybody
stands up and joins and sings along.
I haven't sung for years. Okay, let's pick a key here.
Happy trails to you
until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then. I don't know the rest of the song.
Well, anybody know the song?
That's it.